Food Safety Summit. How many of you were here last year? Awesome. Okay, so I assume, how many of you have come beyond Kalamazoo area? Oh, wow. Okay, let's narrow it down a little bit. How many of you come beyond Southwest Michigan? Okay, you don't have, you're the speaker. Bill's from Traverse City, so he doesn't know. So people can go up. Oh, my cat, yes. Yeah, he drove all the way down yesterday through the snow. And I think we brought some here. We were not supposed to have snow in here. It's all your fault. Okay, so we're going to go ahead and start today. The conference actually lasts today and tomorrow. And today and tomorrow, you will have many different rooms to go. So I'm going to go through a few slides with you so you know where you're going to. And some of you actually will be going to our another campus. So there are directions that will be given to you on a map that you can take to you so you will get lost in Kalamazoo. So first of all, we do have Wi-Fi on this campus. If you open the internet windows on your cell phone, on your computer, you should be able to just say you want to have to connect, and then you should be all set to go, okay? You will see all the fancy plug-in here. You will not have it after 10 o'clock, so none of you will be in this room. So if you need to charge your phone, now is the time. So you are right here in this building. And as I said earlier, we will be doing quite a bit of different room things. So, so every one of you have a name tag, right? Okay. So you will see on the name tag, this side on your right-hand side, on your name tag at the bottom, there's a room number there, and that's for your PSA training. That's for this morning after the keynote sections, and for tomorrow morning. So everyone find the room number there? So either it's B1100 or 22 or something.
1420-2.
So if you look at the map, you're here. If you go to 1422 is right here. So you go out, you turn the right hand side, and you will have to go down the hallway. Someone will be there directing traffic so you won't get lost in this building. And then the other room is on the left hand side of the theater. Okay? So don't worry if you get lost, it's not that big. And it's a circle. And then there's a ladies' room on this, on the green. Those are the washrooms that you can use today. And then we also have a second floor. So when you go out to the theater, there's two stairs. And then the stairs will take you to the second floor. And that's where the lunch is going to be at lunchtime. So we're not going to staff you to that. So as I say, there's west stair and the east stair. So we would really appreciate if you can split into two lines, because there's so many people, there are more people coming a little bit later today. So in order to make the traffic worse, so two lines would be easier than one. Okay, so we will have Nero talk about all the food safety spectrum. I know last year when I started, I was kind of get turned around by all the names about certifications and everything. And that's the reason why we're here today. We would like to work with you and help you to understand all the food safety driving words and everything. So Mira's going to help us out.
The alphabet soup of food safety. Good morning, everyone. My name is Muriel Wardman with MSU Extension Community Food Systems, based here in Kalamazoo at Kalamazoo Valley Community College Food Innovation Center, which some of you will get to visit today during the post-harvest handling workshop. Today, we are here, many of us are here for the Produce Safety Alliance training. There's also a lot of other activities going on. And what we're trying to really do is create a culture of food safety within our farming community in Michigan. And so there are many ways to achieve this goal. As you probably know, this slide is probably familiar to a lot of you who were here last year, who have been in some of our other food safety trainings. But we know that everyone is at a different point in their food safety journey. Those are all good things, and we have a spectrum of ways that we can achieve food safety goals, whether that's through meeting regulations, if we're subject to those, or having food safety plans, or doing some of the voluntary programs that we have available to us. So I'm just going to run through some of those just to get us acquainted with where those all kind of lie. And we'll have people trickling in this morning because everyone's kind of coming at different times. So feel free to go in and out, help yourself to breakfast, all of that. Okay, so food safety spectrum. And this is not all inclusive, but these are some of the major programs that you may be familiar with. So many of you are here today to take the PSA training from the Produce Safety Alliance, which will help you comply with the new FSMA regulations. So that is a required food safety program for those who who fall under that regulation. So that is kind of on the one side of the spectrum. And then on the other side of the spectrum, we have voluntary certification programs. So how many of you are GAP certified already? Great. And any of those are group GAP certification? All right. So we have kind of two different versions of the GAP program here in Michigan. We have the traditional GAP program, and obviously that's, you know, one farm participating on their own, the auditor's going out specifically to that farm. And then we have our group GAP program, which is really beneficial for some of our smaller growers. They can share the resources involved with that program, get a little bit more support and community around it, and then share the cost of that auditing program. So we're really fortunate to have a really great group GAP network. And some of you are signed up for that class tomorrow, and Phil Britton is here as well, who is, what is your title for this program? The director of the group, Michigan Group GAP Network. So if you're interested, be sure to talk to Phil. He's a great resource for us, as well as Daniel Davis, who some of you will see this afternoon at the Food Innovation Center. And he is our local contact here for the group GAP program. HACCP certification is another type of certification. More large growing operations tend to have that one, especially if they have some kind of on-site food processing. So we have a lot of different variation that works well for different sizes of growers. And then we also have some food safety planning tools. The Michigan Safe Food Risk Assessment is one of those. That's coordinated through our conservation districts. Locally, I think we have some folks from the conservation districts here. So be sure to seek out those folks if you have questions about that. And we also have a food safety plan writing workshop, both today and tomorrow. So having a food safety plan is really one of the first and most basic steps toward achieving your food safety goals. And so we have resources here to help you either get started on that today or tomorrow, or work on your existing plan and tweak it and make it a little bit better. So lots of different options, lots of ways to achieve these goals, and we're here to support you through the process. So turn it back over to Vivi.
Yes. So thank you, Muriel. So one of the things that we are really excited today, I know every one of you are here for the PSA, sign up for the PSA training. So in case any one of you think you're not quite ready for PSA and you want to know more about food safety, we have Steve. Steve, would you like to stand up? Steve from Wallace Centers, he actually flew in from
Albuquerque.
Okay. So he came in last night and he's had volunteered to hold a session. So if you want to learn more basic food safety planning today and tomorrow itself, your PSA, he will have a workshop right in this room. I will let you talk. I love to talk. So if you want to take Steve's sections, and so we will have another PSA training probably on this campus on somewhere in Kalamazoo, and then you can come back and do the PSA for free again. We will honor the certifications that you guys are supposed to get today. So if you feel like you want to spend more time to learn about the basic of the food safety, and you want to defer your PSA training, you can come back in September. We will definitely call you back. And here's Steve Gruber.
Yeah, looking at the food safety spectrum, we're focused all on the Food Safety Modernization Act. And the Food Safety Modernization Act compliance is not the same for farms of all sizes. So particularly for small and mid-scale farms, it is often useful to start with the ABCs of food safety. How does it affect you as a business? How does it affect you as a farm operator? And I've dealt with that now for 7 or 8 years on my own family farm in New Mexico. And through the Wallace Center, I've been working with other trainers to develop really a beginning farmer food safety, or food safety beginnings for farmers, depending on how you explain it. And would welcome the chance to share what we've learned and help the smaller and mid-scale farmers be ready for compliance without taking too big of a leap as your first step. And I really appreciate Vivian supporting all of you by extending the option of Produce Safety Alliance training to you at a future date, even if it turns out that today you wish to start with more farmer-focused training. It'd be my honor to deliver that to any of you who wish to receive it.
Thank you, Steve. So Steve's class will be in here. He will be holding his class in here. So we may just slide right into our keynote speaker, Dr. John Fisk. He's a director at the Wallace Centers at Wheelock International. He's actually in Michigan, but he goes to DC on a regular basis for his work. He has over 25 years experience in sustainable food and agriculture system development. He did a lot of training, application and research, program design, project management, philanthropy, and evaluations work. One of his biggest and most important work is with Kellogg Foundation that really helped to set up the whole Michigan's good food and equity, the systems that we have right now in the Four Nations. And he's also the board member of the Food Routes, Michigan Food and Farm System, and editorial members of the Journal of Sustainable Agriculture. So I'm gonna pass on the mic to John.
Thanks, Vivian. Can you all hear me? Modernization Act represents a historic change in regulation of food from farm to fork. Establishing risk-based preventative controls for the production of food and calling for an integrated food safety system. FDA estimates that of the 121,000 farms across the country, 35,000 will be covered under the Produce Safety Rule of the Food Safety Modernization Act, or FSMA. Of those, 76%, or 26,000 of them, are small or very small farms, probably including many of you. So there's 26,000 farms that anticipate being affected across the country. This is the first time in history that farms have been fully subject to enforceable federal food safety standards. auditing of farm practices has long been driven by market requirements, right? It's been voluntary. It's up to the buyer generally, rather than these government regulations. The market requirements from buyers and other supply chain partners are driven in turn by consumer preferences, advocacy groups. This new sort of modernization of the food safety regulation can be an intimidating proposition, particularly to those of us who recall similar regulations coming down in different sectors of the food industry, like meat processing, and how the adoption of those requirements has driven consolidation in the industry and, in time, the loss of small businesses. And yet, FSMA also comes at a time of great opportunity. Consumer demand is driving a significant shift in the U.S. food supply, a reestablishment of local and regional food production and distribution systems with small and mid-sized farms like yourselves as the primary suppliers in the communities across the country as the beneficiaries, right? Making that stronger link between the farm and the community through these sales. This evolution in the food system is allowing local and sustainable agriculture to move from the margins into the mainstream, and in doing so, improve the public health. By increasing access to healthy, green, fair, and affordable food. Now we know that this was first led by consumer-facing markets such as farmers markets, roadside stands, community supported agriculture. However, we also know that the lion's share of food is sold to retailers and institutions and through intermediaries like food hubs and other local food distributors and wholesalers. Michigan is no stranger to any of these markets, right? Michigan farms sold $459 million worth of local food in 2015, making it only second to California in local food sales. Now that's according to USDA's new local food marketing practices survey. So that's the freshest data we have on that. So second only to California. Now, granted, it's a far second, but it's still only second. So it shows the work you're doing here, and it shows the collaborative nature of what's going on in Michigan. Nationwide, 66% of direct farm sales, some $5.8 billion in farm gate value, were not direct to consumers. They were not the farmers' markets and the CSAs. But they went to schools and universities, hospitals and institutions, and they're on the shelves of retail stores across the country, which is where the majority of people get most of their food, right? Many of these wholesale buyers require a third party to certify that producers are adhering to good agricultural practices. This growing demand for audits from the buying community has created a whole food safety industry with competing standards, services, and requirements, many of which come at cost to you. In short, many of you are here today facing dual pressures. On the one hand, you've got compliance with new federal regulations through FSMA. And on the other hand, you've got the long-standing compliance and expectations of the buyers. So what do you do, right? On the one hand, you could opt out and you could stay small, right? But that amounts to saying my business plan is to stay small, but what I've just shown you that the majority of the market, and it's growing, is in wholesale market. On the other hand, we can allow it to force consolidation, right? Or as Earl Butz told us in the 70s, infamously, get bigger, get out, right? So you got these two opposing options. Today, I want to propose an alternative vision. I think it's one that Kalamazoo College supports. One that helps small to mid-sized farms and businesses benefit from the strong market for local and sustainable food that's good for communities, the environment, and our health. And that is that we accept our shared responsibility for minimizing the risk of pathogen contamination in food. Listen, we got to understand that the populations that need our help the most, right? Children, the infirm, and the undernourished are also the most vulnerable to illness. Rather than avoid food safety demands or let them drive consolidation and unwanted scale, we can work together as farmers, agencies, support organizations to develop and deliver trainings and tools that are relevant to a diverse practices, values, and production. Here in Michigan and around the country, local food practitioners, advocates, educators, and delivering resources tailored to distinct needs of our sector. We're going to hear about more of those in the panel. We're going to hear more about those over the next 2 days. They're designing, coordinating, collaborative, and innovative systems to meet regulatory challenges so that it's no longer a barrier to growth in local and regional food systems. And above all, they're working to cultivate a culture of food safety. And what is that? You know, that's really that opt-in attitude, right? It's a culture of food safety that starts with an attitude that says it's only possible when you know what you have to do. And you understand why it's important, and you're confident in your ability to get it done. Right? So it's a willingness. And your willingness to come here today to take trainings and understand, I think, demonstrates the culture that we're trying to build. But it also puts you on the forefront of the nation. We don't see this kind of collaboration and this kind of attitude everywhere. So the challenge is to working together, because the vision I propose is one of working together in a coordinated way, but there's challenges in working together. They're not small, but the opportunity is still larger. Integrating a culture of food safety into our farms and food businesses is an important and perhaps critical step in expanding our share of the market and increasing the vitality of small and mid-sized farms. The local and regional food market is perhaps the best opportunity that farmers have had in a long time. And food safety is a fundamental entry gate. You've got to kind of get that done in order to seize that opportunity. And that's where the culture comes in. So let me give you a brief history of food safety in America. And this is my favorite part, when you get to tell little stories and things like that. You know, it's not so technical. But there's also some, you know, there's some stats in here that are a little effective, and you'll see. In 1993, an outbreak of E. coli at 73 Jack-in-the-Box locations resulted in 4 deaths and 178 permanent injuries, like brain damage and kidney failure. The bacteria originated from uncooked beef patties, and the majority of victims and all the deaths were children under 10 years old. While this was by no means America's first outbreak, the media coverage around the event held the issue in the public eye. Again, this was the early 90s. Additional issues throughout the 90s, including the highly publicized 1996 E. coli outbreak in Adwala juice, right? Fresh juice, now we're moving from beef to juice, getting closer to home, prompted an FDA-led alliance to publish something called the Guide to Minimize Microbial Food Safety Hazards for Fresh Fruits and Vegetables. Right, bullseye. At this point, these were just recommendations. This was a guide. The buying community, responding to concerns from consumers, advocacy groups, and of course, their lawyers and risk management teams, began requiring their suppliers to comply with the recommendations made in the guide. Right, this is the voluntary, buyer-driven food safety standards that we're talking about, stemming from an FDA set of recommendations, FDA-led alliance, was a broader group approach. So from that, on the whole, expectations for compliance are the same, regardless of the size of the farm or the food business, right? A commonly heard phrase back then was, the microbes don't know what size your farm is, right? It's independent of that. That was the thinking, right? Dave Gomes was the recently retired Vice President of Food Safety at the Fresh Produce Industry Association, United Fresh, probably the nation's largest association. That was his phrase, and that was his mantra, right? Because they needed to have a clean supply, or they needed that reassurance of a clean supply. So at the time, buyers needed a way to verify compliance, and many began to use third-party certifiers rather than managing the process themselves. I'm sure many of you are familiar with third-party certifiers in the state. In 2002, in support of farmers and their access to markets, USDA Ag Marketing Service, right, one of the many branches of USDA, developed the Good Agricultural Practices, or what we know as GAP, as well as the Good Handling Practices, or GIP. This was 2002. And this is a standard in an auditing capacity to verify and certify adherence to FDA's recommendations. And these were on a fee basis. So this was USDA's effort to help folks get certified and to support the industry. The comparative affordability and accessibility made by this new specialty crop inspection unit made them a strong partner in local and regional agriculture. When coupled with the TA available through state and federal U.S. state staff, university cooperative extension, food and farm organizations, small and mid-sized farms at the time began to put more and more product into these wholesale or intermediated markets. Then in 2006 came the E. coli breakout in uncooked organically grown spinach, which infected 199 people across the country in 28 states. Response from regulators, consumer groups, and the media was strong and fast. And for the first time, fresh and sustainably grown was seen as the central culprit. It's not beef anymore, it's not juice from California, it's fresh product. The regulations that would become FSMA were already being developed, and this outbreak elevated perceived threats to the public health of both raw vegetables and sustainable growing practices. In January 2011, FSMA received strong bipartisan support from Congress and was signed into law, greatly increasing FDA's authority to regulate the way foods are grown, harvested, and processed. 6 months later, the first reporting of listeriosis began that would become known as the Jensen Farm outbreak, one of the worst ever recorded in the U.S. Now, you may recall they found that it was carried by cantaloupes up in Colorado. The outbreak went on to affect 147 victims, 30 of whom died. This time, the victims were predominantly elderly, with an average age of 83. So like I said, I like history, and I think history is a great teacher. It helps to illustrate two really separate public health mandates driving today's changing food system. First is that, as growers of healthy, green, and fair, and affordable food, your work is critical in addressing the obesity epidemic in this country and our declining natural resources and ensuring that good food is accessible to all people, not just the high-end consumers. To do so, we must produce food that's nourishing, use practices that are regenerative, and build systems that are inclusive and resilient. Right? Local and regional food systems is a contributor to food-related health diseases. At the same time, we must be cognizant that good food for all children, elderly, and infirm, and other vulnerable populations that are far more susceptible to foodborne illnesses than any of us in this room. Food safety is not a box to be checked. It's a duty and a prerequisite to building a sustainable and resilient food system that serves all of us. So let's talk about how we meet these challenges from history and how we bring it into today's work. Over the last 10 years, many organizations around the country recognize the need for food safety education and training and outreach tailored to the needs of local producers. They've initiated partnerships with the USDA, land-grant universities and other colleges, state departments of agriculture and other stakeholders to create alternative programs and trainings and technical assistance. Right, using these collaborative efforts back to the vision of how we go forward, it's a collaborative effort from the federal down to the local. The goal has always been and continues to be the development of relevant and appropriate food safety education that's capable of meeting the needs of all producers, regardless of scale. One strategy for building the capacity of growers to meet the requirements of the wholesale market is working with regional food hubs. How many of you are selling to food hubs or have relationships with a food hub? Hubs complement and add value, offering a combination of production, distribution, and marketing services, intentionally designed to increase market for local growers. The Wallace Center has been working with Michigan State University for a number of years on research, resources, and insights into this food hub sector and its value to growers. We do a survey of that every 2 years. The last survey we did showed us that there's over 400 food hubs across the country, working with over 60 farms each. And if you add all that up, you get into the millions and maybe even the billions of dollars in value. So food hubs are emerging as a farmer-friendly wholesaler and distributor, right? That helps with capacity.
Yeah. So is a food hub what we call a processing plant?
Good question. So a food hub is a bit of a broad definition, and it's really more of an aggregation distribution and marketing. It might be like a food distributor. right, that has a purpose, not just to buy and sell, but a purpose to connect and grow the sector. Right? And in that way, offer services, help with resources, partner on training, things like that. We kind of talk about it as a social enterprise rather than just a business. According to the survey that we did with MSU, 90% of food hubs have a day-to-day operational commitment to increasing small and mid-sized producers' access to markets. And 90% of these hubs are getting exclusively or mostly all of their product from farms with gross sales of less than $1 million. So it's not just their commitment, it's a commitment they're acting on, and they're relying on farmers like you to have that business relationship and to scale up the sector. Hubs can provide more than loading dock. The unique market relationship between hubs and growers, namely their commitment to local supply, creates clear incentives for collaboration on food safety training and compliance. As the wholesale market for local and regionally produced fruits and food, fruits and vegetables continues to grow, fruit hubs have a vested interest in farms of all sizes being effectively trained and able to enter the wholesale supply. Our survey with MSU found that 46% of hubs require some form of regulatory compliance, right? Because they're selling into institutions, schools, hospitals, retail. The people they're selling to are driving it back down. But on top of that, and 75% are preferring or requiring that. But on top of that, many of them, like Cherry Capital Foods here in Michigan, are also providing the technical assistance, the cost sharing, other programs to make sure that growers have the support they need to grow along with the market demand. One being, food hubs can be a partner in achieving food safety certification goals. But let's take a closer look at more innovation that's happening here in Michigan. In 2009, a broad coalition of folks developed the Michigan Safe Food Risk Assessment. How many of you know what that is, Michigan Safe Food Risk Assessment? Has anybody used it on their farm? Okay, we've got some work to do. This collaboration between MSU Extension, the Center for Regional Food Systems, Michigan Food and Farming Systems, the Department of Ag and Rural Development, set out to pilot a tool, right? Kind of a farmer-friendly tool that educators and service providers to use to engage farmers about food safety. They work with farmers to complete independent farm hazard analysis and support them as they begin. The assessment's not connected to certification, right? It's connected to that culture of food safety idea. It's kind of like a low-pressure way of doing it. Very innovative, right? Puts the power in the hands of the grower. If you want to go for certification, it's a great stepping stone. In 2013, billions of progress made through the assessment tool. Additional stakeholders, including us at the Wallace Center and the Western Upper Peninsula Health Department, a series of private foundations, and a group of participating food hubs, launched the first USDA Group Gap program pilot in Michigan. We're going to talk more about Group Gap here on the panel, I believe, but so I won't go into great detail on that. The pilot supported the food safety certification efforts of the Marquette Food Cooperative and the Upper Peninsula Food Exchange. Michigan Safe Food Risk Assessment helped small and very small scale beginning farmers in the UP identify on-farm food safety risks and prepare for that gap audit that I mentioned. As a result, the 10 participating pilot farmers passed their audits and received GAP certification. I think that's a good illustration of using the innovative tools in the state, using the group GAP that came out from the federal level, in partnership with food hubs and others in the state. It really illustrates, I think, the cooperative nature of this culture of food safety. But the story really isn't over. What began as a single effort in the UP has become the Michigan Group Gap Network, a statewide innovative initiative providing training, auditing, and certification support for growers in 5 regions, including here in Kalamazoo. Moreover, Michigan, though certainly a leader in the field, is not alone. Producing these innovative collaborative approaches. This is a national movement. What you're doing is part of a national movement, and it's really critical, as I mentioned, to seizing the market opportunity. So in closing, if there's one message that I want you to take home with you, I hope it's this. You can do this, right? You can do this and you're not alone. The examples that we brought forward and we're going to talk about on the panel illustrate you're not alone. As educators, advocates, scientists, service providers, business operators, network coordinators, and even regulators, we're continuing to foster innovative approaches that meet specific needs of local farms. So thank you for your attention. I hope you enjoyed the history of that. And now I want to invite up our panel members to join me in a more detailed discussion. Like I said, highly qualified, a lot of experience. You may hear something that you want to follow with them after the panel over the next 2 days. So first we have Vicki Zilke, who owns and operates Zilke Vegetable Farm with a large CSA and a busy roadside stand. She works with multiple institutions in the Ann Arbor area to provide workplace wellness markets and with local schools and institutions to increase local produce in cafeterias and dining halls. That is not easy. It may sound easy, but that is not easy. It's good work. Her farm is GAP certified and she's active in the Michigan Group GAP program and other efforts. She's a graduate of the Food Hub Management course, the first of its kind offered by the University of Vermont. Vicki also assisted in the development of the Ypsilanti Marketplace Hub and is a researcher with New Growth Associates working on a number of food and ag projects. She's a longtime resident of Milan, Michigan, and she holds a master's degree in family and child nursing from the University of Michigan. Welcome, Vicki. On my left here is Phil Britton, and he's the director of the Michigan Group Gap Network, a statewide group gap certification effort. Phil's helped develop three separate food gap initiatives in Michigan, two of which were during the USDA pilot phase for food gap. The first was, as I mentioned in my talk, the 2014 UP Food Exchange pilot, where he served as the QMS lead and developed the group's quality management system procedures and records. Late in 14, Phil was hired by Cherry Capital Foods, a food hub based here in Traverse City, to develop a separate group in Western Michigan that achieved certification in 2015. This group expanded statewide and achieved certification in 2016 through partnerships with several regional food hubs. Again, I think illustrating how certification and food hubs are connected, so we'll give you more of that. Prior to Phil's involvement in food systems, he spent 6 years working in quality systems in the medical device manufacturing industry. He currently lives in Marquette, Michigan with his wife and 3 children. Phil, thanks for being here. And Tim Swainski. Tim has 17 years of experience as a food safety professional in the food industry. He joined MDARD in the Food and Dairy Division in 2012 to help identify how the government and industry can help and work together to address food safety issues. Tim's on the National Association of State Departments of Agriculture, FSMA Technical Working Group, and Food Safety and Implementation Team. Is there one acronym for all that?
Be
a sense in and of itself. But that's an important role, right? And what it does is he's played a large role in developing Michigan's feedback to FSMA's proposed rules and the implementation plan. So a direct connection to FSMA here in Michigan, which is extremely important. He has a degree in microbiology from Michigan State University. Prior to MDARD, he worked for several companies, including Cargill and Kellogg. Tim, great to be here. Appreciate it. And as you heard from Steve Wurschauer earlier, and let me just introduce, he's been with the Wallace Center as the Food Safety Coordinator since 2009. Steve is a tireless advocate for the development of scale-neutral food safety systems. He's played a critical role in the development, piloting, and the public rollout of the USDA Group Gap Auditor Program. He's a member of the United Fresh Produce Harmonized Gap Technical Working Group and Calibration Committee. And he's a certified Harmonized Gap Auditor and Trainer. Steve wears many hats. He also serves as the Enterprise Development Manager for the La Marquita Co-op, which is an amazing co-op in Albuquerque, New Mexico. Finally, he's the founder and manager of Mesa Top Farm, a biodynamic farm and learning center, beneficial farm, CSA, a collaborative community-supported ag initiative that supports over 30 farms in New Mexico. So, welcome, Steve. Let's catch him over the next 2 days. Happy to have him with us. So let's start with some questions that we came up with that I think provide some more detail. And let's start at the beginning in terms of understanding the landscape. Tim, this might be particularly for you, but of course everybody's happy to join in. Compare for us the gap over the next couple of years.
Okay, good question. So, we've been talking about is GAP is something that's already out there. GAP certification is a voluntary program. That means that it's not required by the government to do it, even though some people get confused because it is run by the USDA. It's actually a voluntary program, so it's buyer-driven versus the FSMA stuff we're seeing is now a new regulatory standard. There are differences in terms of the technicality of it. GAP covers more in terms of GAP covers pesticide usage, chemicals, and foreign material, whereas FSMA really just covers microbiological contamination. And so that's one big difference. But in terms of the rollout, you know, GAP is something you have to proactively sign up for. You pay for an auditor, you have to proactively go for it. FSMA is going to be different. There's not going to be a registration, there's not going to be a fee, you're not going to have annual inspections or audits. There will be some sort of regulatory program that gets set up with routine inspections, but those aren't going to be anywhere near annual. You know, at this point, when we're talking, when a program gets set up, if it's hitting 10% of covered farms a year, that would be a good thing. So it may be 10 years before a lot of farms ever see an inspector. So it's not something that you're going to. It's different GAP in that way, or any type of third-party program, typically those are annual. Now the bad side of that is if you have buyers saying, I want to make sure my suppliers are FSMA compliant, you also probably aren't going to be relying on a government inspection to do that because it's not going to happen that frequently. So I think those are the big differences. One thing to consider now is before FSMA came out, there really weren't any regulatory standards for growing or harvesting practices from a safety standpoint. Therefore, anybody who required GAP was kind of going above and beyond what the regulations required. Now that FSMA is out, there is a regulatory standard, so it adds some liability to buyers saying, okay, if I'm a grocery store and I'm selling produce and I'm not doing anything to make sure that produce, that the farmers are FSMA compliant, that adds some liability there because now I'm selling stuff that doesn't meet the minimum regulatory standard. So I think it's going to put a little more liability and due diligence on retailers and restaurants to make sure what they're buying is meeting the minimum standards.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I remember when the regulations were proposed as a rule, right? There was a lot of discussion, they accepted comments, there were a couple of rounds of that, there were a lot of revisions. Do you anticipate this being an evolving process that there might be more revisions to the regulations?
Yes, especially, I don't know if they'll go back and change the actual regulation, but what the FDA does is come out with guidance, which really says, here's how we're gonna enforce the regulations. So what happens in the regulation, they'll make certain things a little vague, and then they'll have guidance to say, here's what we actually mean by that, because guidance is easier to change. And I definitely think it'll be an evolving process of how they're going to enforce some of the things and how they're going to view certain activities. And we've also got indication that in terms of water, the water standards, which you'll hear about in the courses, that they're probably going to go back and try and make some changes to that. So we have that indication that their intentions are that they realize it's the way it's written, it's very complicated, and they're going to go back and change it. I don't know if that means that they'll go back and actually change the rule or just how they'll come up with guidance that make it simpler for people to follow the rule. We didn't have a question up here.
Tim,
oh, sure. Thank you.
Just to be specific, when we're talking about FSMA over the next 2 days, we're talking specifically about the produce safety rule of FSMA. Because there are other portions of FSMA that do deal with adulterants that are pesticides and chemicals and physical contaminants and so on and so forth that are other parts of FSMA that aren't covered under the produce safety rule.
Yes, correct. So we are talking about produce safety rule, but that's only a small portion of FSMA. So there's a lot of FSMA really covers the entire food industry. It's not just, there's a produce safety rule that covers farms, There's 7 rules total and then other pieces of FSMA that cover the rest of the industry. So yeah, you're correct. When I say it only covers microbiological hazards, I'm only talking about growing and harvesting practices for their food produce.
So if folks in the room are also doing some kind of facility where they're packing, what, give us just a brief hint of what other parts of the FSMA might affect them.
There's a preventive controls rule which impacts manufacturing facilities. So depending on what type of packing you're doing, the preventive controls rule may impact you as well. So for example, if you're freezing products or cutting product to make value added, then there's a preventive controls rule that's also a new requirement. It covers what, you know, currently you have what's called good manufacturing practices, which is what any manufacturing facility falls under today. There's an addition to have a food safety plan to those practices. So it's basically a plans in place to prevent a food safety incident from happening.
Great, thank you. Anybody else want to add to the GAP FSMA relationship?
When it comes to the produce safety rule, there's sort of a logic tree chart that helps a farm figure out how the produce safety rule affects it, how it affects your farm. And summarizing that, first of all, the produce safety rule applies mainly to products that are generally eaten raw. That's where the great risk is present. That's only where we think about the produce-related outbreaks that happen. They were strictly in regard to produce eaten raw. If a produce is cooked, then that kill step eliminates the microbial risk. But then, as John described, the idea that the microbes don't know what size your farm is, the way that applies to produce safety rules, that the FDA has broken the producer world into 3 categories: $25,000 or less of production, $25,000 to $500,000 of production, of which 50% or more is sold within a 4-mile radius or direct to end users. And then the third category is $500,000 or more of any kind of sales. And the produce safety rule applies 100% as written to the $500,000 or more farm. That's called a covered farm. The next category of $25,000 to $500,000 is called a qualified exempt farm, and only portions of the produce rule apply to those farms, and $25,000 or less are exempt. The problem with that designation is that regardless of whether you're covered by the produce safety rule, FSMA applies, and the purpose of FSMA is to establish prevention-based systems to reduce the risk of contamination from your farm. But the important thing to think about with those gradations is that they affect how one complies. And then they also affect the rate at which compliance comes into play for your farm. The very smallest farms are under the 2020 proportions of that rule. So it gives us lots of time to build our knowledge and understanding and our implementation of that food safety culture. We found that there are some farms for which 4 or 5 of those rules apply. Imagine being in that situation. The sanitary transport rule, which addresses what condition do you move the food from farm to market. The preventive controls rule, which applies if you add value to the product, change it from its raw agricultural state to a finished product state. And then the produce rule. And then there's also a rule regarding production of feed. So a farm that produces feed for sale is subject to yet a 4th rule. And so part of what the KPCC and all of us service providers will be doing for you over time is help sort out how all of those pieces affect you separately and together.
Thank you, Steve.
That's the idea.
That's the idea.
No, and my dad said we're going to unconfuse it. That's really what we're
doing. Yeah, you guys are going to unconfuse it. Let's take a question up there.
Steve, you know, Tim and I had this conversation, and we see this conversation going on at MSU a lot too, is that even though you might be exempt legally under FSMA, do you see FSMA still and it's going to be part of your life because of the fact that the market's going to end up saying, yes, you might be legally exempt, but from a market involvement standpoint, we're going to require that you be FSMA compliant. whether or not you're legally required to be FSMA.
Well, part of what I've been, the gradation I've been describing, it says, what does FSMA compliant mean?
Yeah.
And I think that buyers are simply throwing that around now because it is the new law of the land. You need to be FSMA compliant. Jim was describing how, what that actually means in terms of inspection. And that's what we all fear, is FDA showing up at the farm in some form. To what you said about market expectations, they've been around for close to 20 years, and yet even so, here comes FSMA. And so the reason for FSMA is that the public, in various ways, lost confidence in the voluntary approach to food safety compliance. And that's what we do in this country. We don't trust the private sector. We go to the government and say, help us fix this. You know, we need to be protected. So there is and will remain a dynamic interaction between regulation and market-based expectations, because the kind of money that would take to enforce a dual system is money, extraordinary amounts of money that are probably not going to come forward to either our state or local or federal regulators. Now, the exemption piece was very controversial during the political phase, the legislative phase, because the larger producers are the ones who suffer millions and millions of dollars of loss of revenue, and we suffer loss of jobs when a large-scale food safety outbreak occurs. So they were saying, we don't care how small you are, we all share this market, and anything goes wrong affects us all, and affects us the most. So think about Michigan with a very wide range of production scales. We don't want to harm markets for any of the farmers. So that's where, you know, back in the beginning of the legislative phase, we had a real dichotomy between the small producers who are local facing and the large producers who are part of what we know as the global food system. But in the end, we all realized it's one food system because it's about our customers. It's the same customers. So we are thinking now, along with, over that same time period, local food became a larger segment and the quickly growing segment of the food industry. So we now feel our responsibility to all of our customers and our shared responsibility to especially crop producers, you know, vegetable growers and fruit growers of all scales. And that's what we're trying to do in our own ways, catch up with that knowledge that they've had for a long time, but do it in a way that still strengthens our business. The problem with regulation is it's never scale neutral. Every industry that's ever been regulated, leads to concentration, larger enterprises, fewer enterprises, and a loss of small scale. So most of our efforts during the FSMA phase, both the legislative phase and now the implementation phase, is to reach out and support the diversity of our food system. And that's the hardest part of our regulation. It's where the most effort needs to be put, and that's where Michigan has really done nation-leading work to establish and maintain connections from the smallest farms even to the larger farms at the same quality of information.
Yeah, thank you, Steve. Thank you. Just a technical point. I want to make sure you can all hear the panel. Is the volume high enough? Is it? Yeah, you can hear it? Okay, good. Thank you. Let me ask you about this idea of culture food safety and how it looks like on the farm. You're a farmer. What are you seeing at the farm level? And what does that mean in terms of everyday things or relationships to others?
Well, I come at food safety from the perspective of my prior career, which is as a nurse. So as a nurse, we learned about hand washing on day one. Is that better? Anyway. And so to me, it would make perfect sense that you wash your hands after you poop, not before you poop. And the ability to have that conversation face-to-face with the people that I work with and in front of all of you who I don't know is a simple and easy thing for me because I have that background in nursing. So the culture of food safety is a part of who I am as a person. And I am a person that I am because of that background in nursing. And I think it's important for us to normalize the conversations about food safety, just like we normalize the conversations about how we stay healthy. And so I have conversations about healthy food access, I talk about justice for all, but I also talk about hand washing after you poop. All in the same conversation. So on our farm, it's just a simple, straightforward information. The people that touch my food have better have clean hands. They have to have clean hands before they go out to work. They have to have clean hands when they come back from break. You know, so it's a very simple process for us to talk about why it's important that we look at the risks to food safety. Now, we do much deeper dives, obviously, as we get into the nitty-gritty of it, because part of my compliance is making sure that I've done my due diligence as a farmer, a farm owner, to make sure that everybody who touches the food that I grow believes and acts in the way that I feel and the government feels is appropriate. So we have employee training that is clearly identified. We talk about hand washing. We talk about tool cleaning. We talk about clean bins. We talk about worker health and hygiene. We talk about water and thinking about whether water is safe to drink and safe to use on food, et cetera, et cetera.
And do you experience that differently on different size farms? I mean, when it looks like, what does the culture of food safety look like on a good size of a larger farm versus a very small farm? Is it different or is it the same in your experience?
The conversation is the same. The implementation looks a little different.
Okay.
The larger an organization grows, the more checks and balances are put into place. On a small farm, if it's me and my husband and a summer helper, one of my high school kids, it's pretty easy to keep it pretty easy. As the organization gets larger, then you need more formal systems in place. The training materials have to be identified. Well, the way I describe it is, food safety is knowing that you're doing the right thing, saying that you're going to do the right thing, and writing down that you've done what you've said you're going to do. So those three pieces. You're doing it the right way, say that you're going to do it the right way, and then write down and prove that you have done it. And it's that last step that probably hangs
yeah.
people up.
Right. That's good. Let's talk a little bit about the buyer side. I know a number of you are either, as a food hub, you guys are a buyer. And as a farmer, you're a seller. Bill, you probably engage with buyers all the time. And Jerry Campbell is a buyer. Tim, you probably deal with the industry of buyers quite a bit. You're probably on both sides of the fence there. So how are buyers responding to this? What are the concerns they're seeing? What are the expectations? I know we touched on this a little bit, but I want to go a little bit deeper. Specific expectations, what are the trends? How is it going to affect the folks in the audience? Buyer perspective.
I can start if you'd like.
Yeah.
My experience is that I think there needs to be buyer education because I know buyers often don't know what it is they're requiring. For example, when the FDA put out food facility registration, Walmart just says your farm has to be registered with the FDA because that's a regulatory requirement, where in reality farms are exempt, they're not supposed to be registered, but Walmart buyers are saying, no, you have to be registered. I think that's a matter of they probably just don't know. They don't know enough about the registration to know what their farms. And I think that's what happens when you see things like FSMA. They say, okay, you need to be FSMA compliant, but what does that actually mean? And does that make sense if I'm growing potatoes or something that's a lower risk? I think there's always a risk that a buyer is going to go across the board of, okay, you have to be FSMA compliant, I don't care what you're selling, you have to be compliant, and so I think buyer education is needed, which is a challenging piece, and I'm not sure how to tackle that one.
Yeah.
I think another part of that, too, that something that might feed into the buyer education piece is stuff like this with farmer education. Because I think, a lot of times you're right, where a buyer just looking to check off the box, but okay, where's your gaps there? But I think there's a lot more room for a conversation there. Like, okay, well, what, there's a lot of different certifications available. You're asking maybe for this one, but I feel like this one is more fitting to my farm, and here's why. Then I think there could be a little bit more pushback on the buyer from the farmer or even the distributor side saying, here, you should be able to accept this one too, and here's why. And I think that would be like one small piece of the buyer education.
Question. Yeah, please.
You said earlier that the GAP certification covers more than FSMA. If you got GAP certified, would you automatically be FSMA compliant?
Not necessarily. I'm probably not the best person to answer this, but I think There is no FSMA certification. GAP is probably the closest you can come to it. I think for the most part, they do line up. They do overlap each other. There are some differences. And those are working to be resolved. But I don't know if I'd say that GAP covers more than FSMA does, although it does cover like pesticide use and stuff like that, like you said. But as far as just scope of coverage, yeah, they're a little bit different.
Actually, there is a very specific process underway to align GAP with the produce safety rule, and it begins with the harmonized GAP, which was created out of a collaboration between buyers, packers and handlers, and growers. The special crop world experienced, as John described, a proliferation of GAP standards. Some buyers were asking for as many as 4 or 5 different standards. If you were a larger farm and you were selling to Walmart, they wanted one thing, and then Costco wanted another thing, and then XYZ wanted another thing. And then that process, which was called audit fatigue, led the special crop world to come together and say, we need one standard accepted by buyers, audited by any number of different certifiers, but accepted by buyers and applicable to all, including, you know, exemptions. All farms could be expected to follow this. So over a 5-year period, 13 different GAP standards were reviewed and synthesized into a single approach, which became called Harmonized GAP, and was based on a risk assessment system. And risk assessment is a common way of thinking that can be our farms can be approached that way regardless of our scale. Now, USDA Specialty Crop Inspection Division, which partners with 34 states for the auditing of GAP, and Michigan is one of them, USDA, because it is a sister agency to FDA, had the power and opportunity to go to FDA and say, look, we audit to this standard. You need to help us. We need to help you so that this one standard, this one audit, would also cover FSMA. That doesn't mean it's the same as FSMA compliant, but as Phil described, it means that if you're audited to the Harmonized GAP standard, you've met the requirements of FSMA. You're not certified FSMA compliant, but you have met the same requirements. So that third-party audit under Harmonized GAP, delivered by USDA through its partners in Michigan, can make a farm be fully prepared for anything that could be brought forward from FSMA. And at the same time, it's buyer-facing. So Walmart and Costco and whoever has said in the Harmonized GAP development process, we will accept this. Of course, there's still exceptions. The buyer world is free to ask for whatever it wants. And ultimately, the question is, what does a conversation with a buyer look like? So the bigger the buyer, the less conversation there is at the farm to buyer level. The smaller the buyer, be it a restaurant or a retail store or a small local grocery chain, then that farm can have that conversation. And the point that John was making in his talk was about the value of food hub. The food hub becomes the trusted intermediary between the individual farm and the supply chain as a whole, who through programs such as Group GAP can advocate for the farmer, can hold that conversation with the buyer, and in so doing, open new markets through the certification process.
So it feels like we're in a bit of a transitionary phase then. So let me ask this, so if folks get GAP certified, are they harmonized GAP approved?
Okay, the interesting thing about GAP, get a chance, Google on good agricultural practice, and you'll find that that concept across the globe means different things. In the rest of the world, it incorporates 3 pillars of sustainability, which include environmental, social, and these practical food safety concerns. Here in the U.S., GAP came to mean the war on microbes, primarily. And because it was voluntary, the buyers could develop, because it was voluntary and a free market, what John called the food safety industry, multiple GAP standards were developed. So GAP does not mean one thing. Now the purpose of the harmonized GAP was to agree on a meaning for GAP. And so ultimately, the GAP program that opens the most markets is the harmonized GAP program, which is available to everyone in Michigan through the partnership between USDA and Michigan Extension, Department of Agriculture and Land Grant. So the important point is, there are multiple GAP standards. It's difficult to decide which one might apply. The bigger the customer, the better chance that they have their own version that they accept. But the harmonized GAP standard is the most universal. And it is created through a collaborative process so that even disputes can be resolved. is all in that collaborative approach. So it's more grassroots.
Question here.
What sort of costs are associated with becoming compliant or GAP certified, harmonized GAP certified?
For that,
so my husband and I started farming in 2009, and happily had a little CSA and went to farmers markets and talked to our customers and, you know, had this very happy, lovely little life. And then the University of Michigan said, we'd like your food in our dining hall. And we said, oh, we don't do wholesale. We like this direct-to-consumer stuff. And they said, no, seriously, talk to us. We'd like to have your food in our dining halls. And we said, well, give us a couple of years to think about it. So we thought about it for a couple of years, and then this was the time that the FSMA regulations were starting to come out, and it became clear to us that there was going to be more and more conversations about food safety. And so we took the time to go ahead and become GAP certified, and so got our first GAP certification in 2014. So the winter of 2014, we didn't have PSA trainings. There wasn't any place to go, so I did the internet training on my own time. So for me, it took a couple of weeks to look at what I could find in 2014, write up what I thought was a decent enough food safety manual, which is that version of how do we do things, how do I say that I do the things, and where are we going to write them down that we've done what we said we were going. So getting that thought process through my head took a couple of weeks of winter work for me. So what's my winter time worth? You can count that. You can figure that. So 2 weeks of that, I would say 80 hours of that. Then when it came time for the actual, let's invite MDAR, MDAR came down, right? Yeah, MDAR, you know, we applied for the auditor to come to our farm. That is when real dollars started to be spent. And so we were charged $600, $700 for that process. The cost of that is their travel time from their office, the time they spend at the farm, their travel time back to their office, calculated in an hourly rate. So the check that I wrote was somewhere in the $600, $700 range. The time was stuff we were already doing. I didn't count my hours in developing those couple of hours in the winter, those couple of weeks in the winter, or the intentional making sure we were writing everything down that we said that we were going to do. I didn't put a dollar value on that.
Did you have to make any changes on the farm that cost you money? Water, fencing?
We didn't make any big level changes on the farm. We did do some, well, that makes sense, changes. We have an outdoor wash and pack facility. It's the back side of a building. And we have excellent resources here in Michigan. So Phil Toko came to our farm and did a walkthrough. Phil Toko met with us early in the cycle.
Prior to the inspector coming. Right.
Prior to the 2 weeks of spending time doing my own internet training, you know, he was part of my resource. He said, go look at this, go look at that. He didn't do any of the writing. I did all the writing. But he came out and he recommended perhaps some bird netting over the rafters so that we were intentional about saying, I don't need birds nesting over my fresh produce. Simple things like that. So the very first year was the year we had to submit. We didn't pass at the time of the audit. Well, you never do pass officially at the time of the audit because it's got to go up through the chain and back down again. But usually when the auditor leaves, you have a sense whether or not you're going to have passed. And the first year, we were told that we needed to tighten up some paperwork on some compliance. What we said we did was we didn't use any biosolids on our farm. That's what we wrote. In our food safety plan. But in the conversation, and he asked about fertilizers and pesticide uses and whatnot, and he said, well, we use a fish emulsion, you know, Neptune's Harvest. That's a standard organic approach to thing. We didn't have documentation of that. We didn't have the label on site. we didn't have the dates of the application with us at the time of the audit. So that hung up the pass that day. It took us a little bit of going back through field notes, simple enough to go back to where the fisher, like we'd used up the fisher motion, there wasn't a bottle sitting around anymore. It was pretty simple to go buy a new bottle, get the label on site, get a copy of the label, and then to, by looking back through farm notes and field notes, identify the dates of application. I created a document that proved that we used an approved product on these days, sent the corrective action back to the state, and we were certified. Good question.
Yeah, very good question. Up in the back there. I just want to touch on one, thing that I didn't, because we talked about pass, fail. When I was saying the difference between the regulation and GAP certification. So for regulations, if you're going to get an inspection, there's not a pass-fail. It's just a regulator will come out and say, here are a list of observations that need to be addressed, versus whereas GAP, the auditor may come out and say, okay, no, you don't pass because you didn't get a certain percentage, where the regulation isn't going to look like that. It's just going to, the regulators will walk away with, here's a list of things that we found. It's not that you're going to fail or that something else will happen. So that's one of the big differences to pass fail. Sorry, wanted to add that.
Yeah, thank you.
I just, listening to your story in relation to the question, I wonder about the, like for organic certification, you have to put, with MOSA, I know, that you have to document, you know, your inputs, and you have to show, you know, that it's OMMI approved or ask for approval. So you already go through this process for your organic certification. Is there any kind of cross communications where you can give a password to your dashboard for your account and let them go through that and see all the places in which you documented your inputs and your field work?
If you are organic certified, you are further ahead of the system than people like my husband and I who say, oh, we're not organic certified, our customers don't care, we use organic practices. So we haven't developed those systems that a farm that's already following organic, that is organic certified through that NOP.
Sure.
So if you're NOP certified, you are already there.
I appreciate that. What I'm frustrated with is the redundancy. And then it equates the time spent. And if it's fractured and there's not a way to just say, here's an efficient way for you to look into what I do, I already do this with my certifier. You're asking for a whole other set and pile of hours devoted to communicating. Something you already have to do, and it makes it distasteful. I'm doing things two and three times to seek approval from a different institution. If there's any way to consider, you know, making some of these already completed platforms available to an auditor to review on their own time.
My understanding is that a GAP auditor would be delighted to look at your organic documentation. Mm-hmm.
I was going to say,
there's a software program that you might be interested in. It's called COGPRO.
Yeah,
that you can give a password to a certifier and they can examine your program online. That's all your documentation.
I don't know how big an OMRIT or an NOP manual is, but we have a group GAP manual. And if they're big, if you had a 3-inch binder, for example, you could just have a section back, which is the records. And then whoever your auditor is, their time can just pull up. Also, they don't just show up at your doorstep and give you 5 minutes notice.
Sure.
So if you just had in your organic one, make a photocopy that did, like they say, hey, we're going to come in 24 hours. You're like, I'm assuming at that point you would make sure that everything's in order. And you just make a photocopy of that sheet of paper and copy that. You don't, as long as you know where they are, that's the important thing. Not that you're following a certain protocol.
We're a little close on time, and I want to make sure that we lay out a little bit about eGAP. This is one of the innovations we talked about. It brings together a variety of different players in the system so that you're not on your own.
John, I'm going to try and connect the dots a little bit on this. 90 seconds. From working with farmers, I've seen that there's a great advantage for organic certified farms, which is the record-keeping systems are already in place. And most of what we're talking about with food safety hinges on creating records. So what happens is your records become multi-purpose, and that addresses through multi-purpose record keeping, it does a couple things. It helps you with your workflow. It reduces the burden of additional administrative costs internally. And if those multi-purpose records are a huge chunk of the work you're preparing for food safety. And there is advocacy work going on at the national level to get the NOP and the certifying body, or the FDA implementing bodies, to align better. The point's taken. But from our end, it's about work record keeping that fits our workflow and accomplishes multiple purposes.
Okay, so yeah, Sean's team, let's talk a little about Food Gap. What is it? What does it do for us? We'll get to you soon.
Okay.
How is it different? And how's it playing on your machine?
In 5 minutes. The colleague of mine said that 80% of my job is explaining what my job is. I guess the easiest way, and there's a presentation on this tomorrow too, so I'll see a lot of that information for that. But I think the easiest way to think about it is, if you have the USDA in automated farm, the traditional GAP model, whether that be up to the USDA GAP standard or the harmonized GAP standard, Group GAP stretches that out a little bit and puts a central entity in the middle. And that central entity, working with a group of farms, then does internal audits on each of the farms. And the USDA then verifies that as a system. So it's not verifying it as the farm per se. They will audit the group's procedures and records. They will audit a sample of the farms just to make sure that the system is working. But that's just a different way of thinking about GAP certification. So especially in this area, raise your hand if you are an internal auditor in the Michigan Group GAP program. So what will happen is, if you're a part of the Group GAP program, one of these people will come out to your farm and audit to the same standard. You know, they'll audit your food safety plan, audit your the procedures and records we've been talking about, and but they'll do it as an internal auditor, somebody who is, you know, a lot of times you're already working with through a food hub or something like that. And then if you pass that, that could be it. You could also get, you know, randomly selected to be audited by the USDA, but I don't know, it brings that more level of collaboration to a GAP certification, because these are people that you know and that you trust.
So that internal auditor is a capacity building exercise,
right,
as opposed to an external certification or a check.
Right. So the other part of it too is, you know, like Vicki was saying about how, you know, she had to go through and a lot of it, for the majority of it, figure out how to write a food safety plan on her own. When the auditor showed up, you know, she was like, well, I think this is right, because this all looks good to me. One of the things that we do at the Michigan Group GAP Network is, if this is your first year joining, we will go out to your farm and do a mock audit. It's the same standard, but it's more of like an audit that doesn't count, just more as an educational tool to highlight any areas that need to be addressed before we come out and do the actual internal audit. So what it does is it really makes that step into food safety certification a little bit lower, a little bit easier to take that step up.
And when we say, in this case, when we say Group GAP, what is the group that you're talking about?
The group, well, the Michigan Group GAP is a statewide group. Mm-hmm. And we work, the central entity that I mentioned is based out of Traverse City, but we work with food hubs based here in Kalamazoo and Lansing, the Southeast region, and UP, and also out of Traverse City. And they provide the regional auditing and technical assistance support for those respective regions. But it helps, we're talking about building a culture of food safety. It helps make that statewide and more consistent across the regions, mm-hmm. rather than having separate groups each kind of doing their own thing and fracturing out into the different regions.
Right. Or even separate farms, right? You run one step beyond the farm to group to state. Steve, did you want to add anything to that?
Yeah, I'll describe what my experience was as a farmer getting into this whole process. I think that will illuminate what Group GAP brings. I was fortunate through support from the Wallace Center to be a lone small farmer voice in the harmonized GAP working group that was created. And I sat in rooms full of industry people, who men and women who knew stuff about how to do the job right. And but every time I leave, they're going, how am I ever going to get access to this expertise? I mean, I'm on a $35,000, $40,000 farm. I'll never be able to hire or gain access to these skills, and I want them. They help my business, they help my customer, my face towards the customer, they help me do what I'm really responsible for. And what I realized was, just like, that if a group of small farmers aggregates the their resources. We become like a larger entity. These larger entities, just because of their human resources infrastructure, can hire an expert, and that becomes their expert. We can't have an expert. We can't afford an expert. And the centralized entity becomes our expert. They become the people who make sure we have the latest technical information, the latest implementations. And then when the process of auditing or inspection begins, they are our intermediary. On a larger farm, when the inspector shows up, a quality person meets them at the gate and says, let's go to the conference room. Let's look at our records. Who meets them at the gate at our farm? We do. Our production for the day stops. Even when we're passing the audit, we can barely do our jobs. So it was essential to figure out a way that we as small entities could aggregate and get that kind of skill and resource working for us. In the rest of the world, 86,000 out of 100,000 farms are certified in groups for exactly that reason. In the rest of the world, small producers are often they're in emerging market countries with little formal education. They're just farmers. So in order to access markets, somebody has to be the voice. And that's what we get from Group Gap. The centralized entity gives us a voice, and it's a two-way voice. It's skills to us, and it's advocacy for us out into that food safety world.
Thank you. Let's go back to that question up there before we run out of time.
Hi. There was a couple of things in the cost that I'm looking at, because we are Gap certified, and one of those is sampling, and it's required for Gap to sample water, produce. We test every week. The water is tested to establish 5 times in a row, and then it's tested monthly, and then the produce is tested weekly, or as we move through harvest. So that's a cost. It's not a great cost, but you do have lab costs with that. You have to work that in and know those things are there. And the paperwork is pretty extensive, too, because you have to keep record of it all.
And that's part of your GAP certification.
Yeah. I don't know if that's
others experience that
consideration or about if it's too minute.
I mean, in terms of GAP versus FSMA, the water, there is a water testing requirement as well. So water, there's not a product testing requirement. So I guess it would be different in that way. I think the water testing requirement. Testing as well. And it depends on your source too. If you're using well water, then it's one test a year versus surface water, I think it's 5 tests a year. Municipal water, no tests. You just need something from the municipality. So it depends on your water source, but yeah, water testing would be a cost as well.
Right.
Maybe it's the development of the plan then, because we do test monthly after we've established a basis.
Sounds like you better catch Tim after this and then you can save yourself some money. You got another question there?
Currently, Global Gap version 5 is certified, and I'm unclear how the harmonized gap might be related to that.
I'd like to answer that to you looking at the time and the really deeply technical nature of your question in the end, I'd be happy to talk to you through one-on-one. But I think it would make the rest of our eyes glaze over and not wanting to do it.
I think this has been fairly stimulating for a food safety deep dive, don't you? Let's give our panel a hand. I think we're moving. Vivian, what's next?
So every one of you kind of get an idea of what you're getting into in the next couple of days. It's a lot of food safety knowledge to learn. We're really here to work together as a big group in Michigan to promote the food safety cultures in the Michigan area. We realize there's a lot of small growers in this day. And if we work together, we have but one big entity. So today, we're going to focus on the PSA training. What I want you to do is look at your name tag and look at your right-hand corner, on this corner. Okay. So let's show him real quick. Who's at the B11? That's okay. So you're in the B11 1100, and that's in that side of the room. And if any one of you go to C1420, okay, that's on that side of the room, okay? Now, as we talked about it earlier, if you decided not to go to the PSA today, you want to come back in September, Steve will be doing a beginner's Farmer's Food Safety. That will be in this room. So don't worry if you don't get your PSA today, you will be able to come back and do it again. Yes.
Question. The PSA training, does that also count for in GAP, those first few questions require a training? Does it also count for that?
Yes.
Now,
and then this afternoon, we'll be doing the food safety planning workshop and the post-harvest handling workshops, okay? And we can talk to the after a lot of time. And that's the room number on this side of your name tag. If your name tag on this side is say FIC, you will be going to another campus. You will have to drive yourself to another campus for that section with post-harvest workshop, okay? So we'll talk about that in a minute. So meanwhile, we will just break into two rooms, and then Steve, you.
This is real important. For internal auditors, the PSA training also counts towards your continuing education requirement.
Okay, so let's get some fresh coffee. There will be another registration in your room for the PSA training.